We've got the Alfa Romeo Giulia in Verde Visconti Metallic.
You know, we've had the Stelvio a couple of times, but never the Giulia, so I'm excited to drive this.
All right, we're in the Giulia from Alfa Romeo.
And it sure feels good.
Andrea, what's under the hood?
A 2-liter turbocharged 4-cylinder engine with an 8-speed automatic transmission, 280 horsepower and 306 pound-feet of torque. It goes 0 to 60 in 5.1 seconds.
So if you want a higher horsepower turbo 4-cylinder engine, this might be for you. We have another one coming up in 4-year consideration.
And we've got our hot topic, questions, coffee, and cars, and stick around for reliability and quality numbers in our vital stats.
But right now, it's time to find out, what do you get with this Giulia?
Here are the key standard features of the Giulia: an 8.8-inch touchscreen, center console rotary dial controller, a 7-inch full-color instrument cluster, Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, heated leather front seats, a heated steering wheel, rear parking sensors, remote start, and 17-inch wheels.
So they've got this dial here. It says DNA, dynamic, normal, and then I guess adaptive. What do we need to put it in?
You've got to put it in S for subscribe. And if you can hit the notification bell, you'll be notified when the videos drop, and then you can watch them all.
So we do these couple car reviews twice a week. We put the first one out on Wednesday afternoon.
We drop another couple car review on Saturday.
On Monday, it's the live show. Get your questions in.
Tuesday, we always have a comparison.
And on Friday, it's a cool, fun, or collectible car. And the only way you're going to find out when all these videos drop is to follow Andrea on Instagram, motormouth_Andrea. That's how you get your questions in too. And for me, it's motormouth_auto, and the links are below.
This video is brought to you by CarCost Canada. Get the dealer's cost, list of rebates, plus discounted interest rates. Use the promo code MOTORMOUTH to become an expert member and get extra searches. The link is in the description below.
In a world of everything being the same, boring, homogenous, we have something different. She's Italian. What do you think of the way this looks?
Oh, just so dreamy. I mean, what a car. I love the V Scudetto grille. You know, it was introduced in 1934 and it's changed over the years. It means little shield in Italian. And I think it looks fantastic.
The color is gorgeous. Oh. Like this dark, it's kind of like a British racing green, but got metallic in it.
Yeah.
And then when you combine that with this gorgeous interior, it's a stunner.
It's a stunner.
And the wheels, it's the stance of this car, I think, is really good.
And what about those yellow brake calipers? Do they not look great? And they are standard on this trim.
One thing I would say though, Andrea, I find the back part of that generic homogenous group. I was driving the other day while we were doing the car-to-car shooting.
Yeah.
You can see exactly my angle when I was driving along. And I think this has a bit of a Mazda kind of back end, Mazda 6, in my opinion. It doesn't really look dynamic. If you had the Quadrifoglio with the big exhaust tips, that would look good.
But you know what, Zach? When you look at BMW from the back end and even Audi, they're all quite simple and plain. And mm-hmm. I think that it's kind of a nice combination between that big front grille that we see and all that history associated with Alfa Romeo to have a simple back end.
You seem to be in love, so that's okay. You like it. I think it could be a little bit more dynamic. Anyway, let's get into the inside, because I'm usually not a fan of this kind of like a baseball mitt color interior, but it's all about the tone. We had, what did we have recently? A Pacifica Hybrid?
Yes.
That had this sort of like orangey gold barfy looking color. This
yes.
one looks fantastic.
Well, leave it to the Italians to make beautiful leather and a beautiful color. Remember when we were in Venice, Zach, and Zach had to decide on this duffel bag, and it was this gorgeous tan, and it really reminds me of this. And Italians know how to make good leather.
We traipsed back and forth across Venice and all the bridges in the canals, and she was a hot. We found the bag. And you know how many times I've used it? Once.
Hardly ever, but he had to have this bag.
Still have
Go
it.
Go figure.
I'll show it. Here's a picture of it. It's beautiful.
It just hangs out in the closet mostly. I find these seats to be very comfortable. We've talked about the sport seats in the BMW, pretty firm. That's not the case with this. I could totally take this on a long trip and be very comfortable.
This is a really nice car to drive every day. very, very comfortable, and I do love the interior.
The center console is very simple, and this armrest where the storage is, it is the perfect place for my hands. For the driver, on the right you have the volume knob, and on the left you have all the drive modes. I don't even have to look, it just feels so natural.
The best way to describe the screen and the interface, it's very much like BMW's iDrive. It's based on the same kind of philosophy, so it actually is really quite easy to use. You know what? There were some questions about the interior, so let's get into it now.
Time now for questions, coffee, and cars.
Your questions from Instagram.
This car keeps me up at night. Real talk though, Julia or 3 Series from BMW, I'm talking about best driving dynamics. For me, 2-liter 4-cylinder turbo, this one. Mm-hmm. Inline 6, BMW, Quadrifoglio, Julia.
If you go and search up awards that this car has won, the first time this ever came to my attention, I was flying to Europe on Lufthansa.
Nice.
In business class, Andrea, upstairs,
of
in,
course,
the upstairs in the 747.
Yeah, fun.
That'll be you soon.
Yeah.
And there were no English magazines except one British car magazine, and it listed all of the bests in all these categories. And Alfa Romeo was like, they keep winning.
On the top.
And then I drove one and I'm like, ah, I get it. Handling, it's Alfa Romeo.
How is rear seat space? A sports sedan has to do the sedan part of the job well, too. Mm. So true. Yeah. Yes, right? If you need the extra space. It may look a little tight. It's not. Mm. It is right on par with the German brands. There's actually a little bit more front row leg room in this one compared to the German brands, but rear seats are the same, and same with headroom. Lovely car. What are the upgrades for this model compared to the previous one?
They're quite minor, actually. They did the exact same thing with the Stelvio. It's mostly interior.
Yeah.
They upgraded the center console. It used to have cheap-looking plastic. They made that look better. A big one is the infotainment screen and some modest changes on the outside.
Yeah, and they reduced their trims. They went from 7 to 4. Like Zach said, it's now a touch screen, and it comes standard, this 8.8. So you've got more standard features now in this. Even Brembo brakes are standard. Mm-hmm. The 10-way passenger driver seat is also standard. So more standard features.
The shifter's now leather wrapped. That's a nice feature.
Yeah. Apparently, the interior materials were improved in last year's refresh. Have you noticed that it to be the case? And does the interior feel up to snuff with the competitors? So we kind of touched on that a bit in the last question. One thing that this doesn't have is the larger screens. All the German competitors come with bigger screens than this, except for the BMW 3 Series. It does come standard with an 8.8-inch screen, but you can upgrade to a bigger screen. When you look at Mercedes-Benz, for example, and that C-Class is on its way out, it already has standard 10.25-inch touchscreen and a 12.3-inch digital instrument cluster. And another thing, Zach, no ventilated front seats on this.
I'm okay with the smaller screen. I truly believe you're using the same information, you're just making it bigger. Like, you use the phone, you use the radio, and a few other things.
Yeah.
It doesn't need to be ginormous. That's my thought on it. And then the materials in here is as good as everybody else now.
And also, this comes standard with leather seating, whereas BMW and Mercedes-Benz gets faux leather, and Audi has leather seating surfaces.
Okay, not faux leather.
No. And that's it. Thanks so much for all your questions. We love interacting with you.
And if you want to get a question in, make sure you follow Andrea. It's motormouth_Andrea. Because you hear the music, it's time for Nightlife. We keep one question back from Questions, Coffee, and Cars and expand on it. It's our hot topic. What's this one, Andrea?
Alfa. Journalists love them and owners curse them. Consumer Reports gave them a far below average for reliability. This car is a lease for sure, and likely a love-hate relationship will follow. But during the love phase, lots of hearts. Well, there you have it. I think that's the elephant in the room with poor Alfa Romeo. It's all about reliability. And Zach, there's a bit of a pain pleasure scenario
matrix
here.
Yeah, I call it the pain pleasure matrix. On one hand, you get all of this pleasure from driving such a wonderful car. It looks great. And then on the other side, potentially some pain with maybe having to go back to the dealer more often than you would with, say, a Lexus.
Yeah.
So does that meet in the middle? That's the pain-pleasure matrix. Are you willing to put up with some pain in order to get the pleasure? That's really what it comes down
to. And some of our followers, you know, they've got the Stelvio and they've had no issues with it. Julia, on the other hand, they've had some issues with it. But one of them said, you know what, I think I just might go back for more.
Well, once you've experienced this car, it can get under your skin for sure. You have somebody in Australia that follows us that bought one, right?
A Stelvio.
A Stelvio, okay. Yeah. And a colleague of mine in Toronto that runs Sharp Magazine, he had a Quattrofoglio Stelvio for a few years and he had zero issues with it. So, you know, I think a lot of this is hyped up. A lot of people say, you know, it's the same way they say Ford can't make good cars, neither can GM. Of course they can. And I think people are saying the same thing about Alfa. So the point they made in the hot topic was lease it. That's the best advice. I call it the 3-year test drive.
Yep. And if you want to keep it, get an extended warranty after that if you're worried about reliability. Hey, the other thing is the Germans, I pulled the numbers and actually Alfa Romeo doesn't do as poorly as maybe we would all suspect. The German brands get a rating of over 80, but not the BMW. It gets lower at 76. And the Japanese brands like the Lexus IS300 and the Acura TLX also get a score of 80 and above.
All right, now let's get into it. What are the vital stats on this, including the quality scores?
The base model Giulia all-wheel drive starts at $51,500. The Giulia T1 Sport is almost $57,000, as tested, $63,385. There is no rating with J.D. Power for the 2021 model, but it gives the 2019 Alfa Romeo Giulia an overall score of 74 out of 100, and for quality and reliability, a score of 75. CarEdge states the Giulia will retain 47% of its value after 5 years.
Here's the fuel economy. The Giulia all-wheel drive gets 10.5 liters per 100 kilometers in the city, 7.7 on the highway. That's 23 miles per gallon city, 31 miles per gallon highway. The warranty is 4 years and 80,000 kilometers or 50,000 miles.
I really love the precise steering on this. I like that there's a stop and start button on the steering wheel. I think that that's a really nice touch. And there's one thing that the turning radius isn't that great on this. I was a bit surprised by it. Not sure why. It isn't a huge vehicle.
Yes, yeah, the geometry of the front suspension. We saw the same thing with a few other brands that have, you know, really good handling dynamics.
Yeah.
They sacrifice the turning radius. I'd be okay with it because I like the way the car drives.
Now, this comes with 17-inch wheels as standard. We have 19-inch on this, but you can get 20 or 21-inch. And Zach and I were talking about the 19-inch wheels, and that's maybe why it kind of feels so good and handles very well.
It looks great. I mean, I thought they were bigger wheels because they're so open. Looks fantastic, but you get that compromise of handling and driving dynamics. I don't think I would go for 20 or 21-inch wheels. I think it would make it too harsh.
And this 2-liter turbocharged engine is just terrific. I don't really feel like I'm driving a 4-cylinder.
There are times though, Andrea, I'll show a couple of shots of you accelerating away here.
Yeah.
Until you get it to about 2,500 RPM, it's got some turbo lag. Once you get it up on the hopper though, it really feels fantastic.
Yeah, and Zach was saying to me, are you gunning it when you're doing these acceleration shots? And I said, yeah, like I am really pushing this, but there's some turbo lag.
Yeah, I asked Andrew to do it like 3 times. I said, you can do a better launch than that, but that's all she has to offer.
Hey, I can do a good launch.
Now, speaking of 4-cylinder turbos, what else can you buy?
For your consideration. 4 vehicles for you to consider.
We're comparing 4-cylinder turbo sedans. First up is the Audi A4. It has a 2-liter turbocharged 4-cylinder with a 7-speed automatic transmission, 261 horsepower, and a starting price of $46,500.
Next up is the BMW 330i. It offers a 2-liter turbo 4-cylinder as well with an 8-speed automatic transmission, 255 horsepower, and a starting price of just over $52,000.
Genesis G70 has a 2-liter turbocharged 4-cylinder with an 8-speed automatic transmission, 252 horsepower, and a starting price of $45,000.
Next is the Cadillac CT4V. It has a large displacement 2.7 liter turbo four-cylinder engine and a 10-speed automatic transmission, 325 horsepower, and a starting price of $46,500. So there are four sports sedans for you to consider.
So the question we have is, would you buy one? Would you take a chance on the Alfa Romeo Giulia?
Type away below. We'd love to hear your comments. I think leasing really is the way to go to dip your toes in the Italian Mediterranean Sea.
It is dreamy. The Giulia is such an engaging and lively sports sedan. I really enjoyed our time with it, and the history of Alfa Romeo is terrific.
But they don't have a history really here in North America, not a modern history, and they have a lot of mountains to climb when it comes to quality, getting people excited about their brand, and getting people to take a chance on these actually wonderful cars to drive.
Yeah.
This video is brought to you by CarCost Canada. Get the dealer's cost, list of rebates, plus discounted interest rates. Use the promo code MOTORMOUTH to become an expert member and get extra searches. The link is in the description below.